Microphone one.
Mr. Chair, Mark Montoni from Virginia.
One second. I want to announce, if the secretary can, the secretary is very busy. I want to announce the candidates that are eligible for the next ballot. They have not been printed yet, but I want you to know who you're eligible to vote for. Gary Johnson, John McAfee, Austin Petersen, Darryl Perry, Mark Allen Feldman. The only candidate who will be dropped from this ballot is Kevin McCormick. Now, microphone one.
Mr. Chairman, Mark Montoni from Virginia. And this is a point of information.
Yes, Mr. Montoni, go ahead.
As a matter of tradition, the Libertarian...
Can we have a little bit, quiet it down just a bit? The gentleman is speaking.
The Libertarian Party has always advocated the recognition of a vote for none of the above in all public and internal Libertarian Party elections. So if you would care to cast a vote for none of the above, it is a valid choice at all times in Libertarian Party elections. So just remember, a vote for nobody means nobody is going to make demands on your time. Nobody's going to be asking you for donations. Nobody's going to be asking you for petitioning help. So.
Thank you, Mr. Montoni. Is there anyone else seeking to be recognized? I see microphone number four.
Hello. Jim Fulner from Michigan, microphone number four. Point of information.
Yes, Mr. Fulner.
According to our rules, shouldn't we allow Kevin McCormick some time to speak to the body?
It is not in the rules. We have occasionally asked for a suspension of the rules in order to allow someone who is dropped to address the body. Is there such a request?
I so move.
For how long?
For 2 minutes.
For 2 minutes. Is there objection to having Kevin McCormick address the body for 2 minutes? All in favor of allowing Mr. McCormick to address the body for 2 minutes, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. Can Mr. McCormick approach stage right so that he may come up and address the body? Oh, he's already on stage left. Look at him. He sneaks up behind you. Kevin McCormick.
You guys are making me emotional again. Thank you, everyone, for your support. Thank you for my 9 votes. I greatly appreciate it. I got into this race to spread the message of liberty. And I need us to all understand that once this voting is done today, we may have multiple rounds ahead of us, that we all need to come together. You may have not heard of such a thing as a black swan event. It is those events that are outside of standard deviations that are out there and they're possible. This year has shown the world that we have experienced multiple black swan events. I am a black swan standing up here right now. I jumped in this race 100 days ago and just received 9 votes, and I was on the ballot. We are dealing with a situation now in this country where our presidential nominee can win this election by just gaining 60 electoral votes. We can change the world this year. I want everyone to understand, whoever wins, we must get behind our candidate and do our grassroots operations and bring this party forward. We can win this election this year, everyone. All we need is 60 electoral votes to send it to the House and prevent that fraud Trump and the prisoner Hillary Clinton from being the next president of the United States. Thank you.
I would recognize microphone number two. There's no one there. Microphone two.
Mr. Chair. I would like to make a motion. I move that we suspend the rules to allow all tokens that were cast for president to be automatically cast for vice president for those candidates wishing to run for that office.
There's a motion to suspend the rules for the purpose of considering the presidential tokens cast for president to be the same as tokens counted for vice president for people who may have run for president who wish to be placed in nomination for vice president once we have picked a nominee. Is that your motion?
That's correct. After a nominee has been chosen.
After the nominee has been chosen. Is there a second for that suspension of the rules? Is there objection? All in favor of suspending the rules in that manner to count presidential tokens as vice presidential tokens for those candidates who wish to seek the vice presidential nomination, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, please say no.
No.
Well, now everybody's going to have to do something different. All in favor of that suspension of the rules, please raise your hand. All opposed to that suspension of the rules. I do not think that that is two-thirds, and so that suspension of the rules will fail at this time. Just as a point of information for the body, well, you'll figure out what it all means soon enough. Is there anyone else seeking to be recognized at a microphone? Without objection from the body, I'd like to invite Mr. McCluskey up to do 12 minutes of speech. Can we put, are the ballots ready, Madam Secretary? The ballots are ready. State delegation chairs, get your ballots at the Secretary's assistance desk. State delegation, start voting. We're going to get this done. And now, Mr. McCluskey.
First off, I'd like to thank everybody for being here today. My name is Rick McCluskey. I'm running for U.S. Congress in the 4th Congressional District of Mississippi. I'd like to thank a few people real quick. Aaron Barksdale, who's our state chair in the state of Mississippi, doing some great things. Mr. Mario Barnes, who coordinated me coming here today. And also my Uber driver, who got me here quickly on last second notice. As many of you know, we're at a watershed moment for the Libertarian Party. I think we all agree on that, correct? Look around you. Look at this. Take it in. It's exposure that you've never seen before. Every major news network is here. This is unbelievable. Your hard work, dedication, and perseverance is finally paying off. Where we once did not have a platform to speak from, now we turn on the TV every day and you see one of our presidential candidates speaking. You can feel it, I can feel it, times are changing. And soon those who found comfort in the two-party system are painfully going to feel it. The party is growing, but we're nowhere close to the pinnacle. The possibility to have a significant impact on American politics lies directly in front of us, and it's incumbent on the leaders of the party, the members, and the activists to go forth and capitalize on this historic opportunity. An opportunity that each one of us are blessed beyond comprehension to witness. Now's the time to take it to the next level. It's happening at light speed, ladies and gentlemen, and we must be ready for the increasing spotlight and the increasing responsibility. Americans have finally grown weary of the failures, broken promises, and incompetence of the two major parties. They look at both Democrats and Republicans and they realize they are cut from the same self-serving fabric that resembles nothing that our founders envisioned. The ideas and principles that were present in the spirit of this nation's founding are long gone, and even the remnants are at the risk of extinction. Democrats and Republicans are proving each and every day that more government is simply not the answer. We look to D.C. and we see a government dictating every aspect of our personal life, rattling our country and generations to come with a $20 trillion debt. Democrats are speeding to a fiscal cliff at 100 miles an hour, while Republicans boast about going to the same cliff at 90 miles an hour. At some point, someone's got to slam on the brakes. The Libertarian Party appears to be the credible option, and finally, many are starting to realize that. With all this said, we cannot accomplish a single thing if we do not grow in numbers as a party. Our collective principles and ideas are something that most Americans will accept on some level. Unlike the other two major parties, our principles bind us together versus a mere party name, which is essentially nothing more than a team jersey that has no credibility if the player wearing it is void of a consistent set of convictions. As the stars align, we see once a seemingly impossible task, such as growing the party exponentially, as an endeavor that is well within the realm of possibility. The question now becomes, how do we make this possibility a reality? The best way I can explain this is simply tell you my journey from being a rank-and-file GOP loyalist to becoming a Libertarian candidate for the U.S. Congress. In my eyes, it had a lot to do with my life experiences and people involved in my personal enlightenment, but most importantly, the framing of a message. In 2008, I was fresh off a four-year tour, United States Marine Corps, which included a deployment in Iraq, and I was a proud 22-year-old man that knew he had the world figured out, especially the political world. I began my freshman year at the University of Southern Mississippi as a political science major. It was by chance that I encountered a man that at the time seemed a little bit crazy. He kept rattling off these ideas that I somewhat agreed with, but certainly they weren't realistic. Danny Bedwell's actually in the audience right now. Danny, stand up, raise your hand, please give him a round of applause. Danny's a former party chair and U.S. congressional candidate. He frequently traveled the state speaking about the true meanings of freedom and liberty. Whenever his travels brought him to my hometown of Hattiesburg, Mississippi, I would receive a phone call asking, hey, do you want to go snag a bite to eat? The conversations that we had planted the seeds that would eventually grow into my understanding of what it means to truly be free. It was guaranteed that after each of these encounters, I would get into my car, watch Danny drive away, and then the conversation with myself would begin. I would tell myself, he's wrong. I don't know quite how he's wrong, but damn it, he has to be wrong. After a few of these lunches, my interest was piqued, but I was not yet convinced. I had to know more about these radical notions that he kept speaking about, so I began to delve into the readings that Danny would suggest. These were my quintessential aha moments. It took years for me to come full circle. There was one thing Danny did that I look back on and I identify as the sole reason it allowed myself to open up to the ideas he was trying to show me. It was the method in which he framed a message, both in words and delivery. For those who may not be familiar, framing a message is a political science term that refers to the manner in which you convey your intended points to others so they can understand in a generally agreeable discourse. Being a Southern Baptist, I compare this to witnessing the gospel. In my experiences, I found that those who are most effective in bringing someone to the Word of God are those who do not constantly beat others over the head with the Bible, but instead they simply highlight the wonders of the ideas that are present. This causes intrigue. It causes a need to know more. Danny gave me just a little of the liberty-oriented ideas to make me want more. I have no doubt that if he had aggressively forced it on me, I would have certainly pushed back, and that would have been the extent of the conversation. Years later, I brought this up to Danny, and he explained it to me like this. Rick, if you force honey down a child's throat, the child will grow to hate it. But if you just simply put a little on his lip at a time, he'll grow to love it. And this is exactly how you spread the message of freedom and liberty. We are so far removed from the ideas of freedom that they may seem foreign and unrealistic to some people. The process of getting them to open up can be very difficult, but if done the right way, it can be possible. Being from South Mississippi, I sometimes encounter those that I may be at odds with on a few issues. I found that framing the message, as far as words that are spoken, can be the deciding factor in convincing someone to be receptive to your ideas. This may involve setting some parameters in which you're speaking in. Since many of my fellow Mississippians identify as conservatives, I inform them that I use the term in the purest form, and I define it as the conservative application of government to my life. This sets a tone for what can turn out to be a very interesting conversation, especially on social issues. You can see the personal dilemma and the cognitive dissonance begin in their mind as they realize that using the government to control someone's personal habits is not conservative yet is liberal, and what we refer to as statist. The main one I've encountered is the one that I'm sure we all have, and it pertains to the non-aggression principle. As I was explaining in a recent interview, I was asked by the interviewer, if you support the ideas of allowing individuals to make their own decisions, where does the individual draw the line? I informed him that he was simply asking the wrong question. if we allow the government to make these decisions for us? Where will the government draw the line? Most people, if they're honest with themselves, understand how that scenario ends. And regardless of their ideology, regardless of their party persuasion, it is not something they're comfortable with. At that moment, you have found a common ground to build on. If we do not frame the libertarian message properly, we run the risk of falling into the same trap as the two major parties, where emotion guides their beliefs instead of reason and logic, which should be the compass. On the surface, our message may not appeal to everyone. What makes sense to us may appear to be unreasonable to others. At that point, we might as well be speaking an entirely different language. Our intent is then lost in translation to those who view freedom and liberty through the lens in which contemporary American politics has provided them with. That is why something as simple as how you word a sentence could be the determining factor in any political discourse about libertarian politics. This can be thought-provoking for you as well. It will force you to approach issues from different angles, but also will provide you with a deeper understanding of the topics at hand. Once again, as many of you know, these are exciting times in American politics, especially for the Libertarian Party. But it's also very troubling times. Millions of Americans are fleeing their parties in search of not just something fresh and new, but something that may actually work. As they're leaving their parties, let us make sure that we do not build a wall around our own, a wall that a certain Mr. Trump would probably be proud of. Instead, let us embrace the fact that the Libertarian Party could be in a fantastic position to receive those people that feel so disenfranchised by the Democratic Republican parties. This will only increase our strength. Just remember what a great American hero once said as he defeated an evil Soviet status in a highly contested and epic battle. At the end of the movie Rocky IV, Rocky stands in the middle of the ring, and he tells the crowd this: if I can change, you can change, we all can change. And yes, I just quoted Rocky Balboa. Yeah. I don't think it gets more American than that. This statement holds true as we prepare to take on these new members. If we all can make the necessary changes, the Libertarian Party will charge forward and reach heights that it's never seen before. But most importantly, we stand a chance to preserve a republic and resurrect the ideas of freedom and liberty. And for that, I do believe history will judge us with an undeniable sense of honor. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McCluskey. I'm Arvin Vohras, Vice Chair of the Libertarian National Committee, and I'll be taking over temporarily for Nick Sarwak. In case anybody has forgotten, if you want to learn more about the Libertarian Party, please go to lp.org. If you want to get involved with the Libertarian Party, please go to lp.org/states or call 1-800-ELECT-US. Right now, as long as there's no objection from the body, I will be inviting to the stage Dr. Marc Miller, who is running for Texas Railroad Commissioner. Marc, please come to the stage. One quick announcement. Credentials Committee, please go to the registration desk right now. Thank you very much.
Gotta say howdy, y'all, from Texas. I am running for the most important regulatory agency in the United States that nobody knows anything about, the Texas Railroad Commission. Now, some of you might be surprised, wait a minute, you're libertarians, you would not be surprised, to find out that the Texas Railroad Commission has nothing to do with railroads. Believe it or not, the Texas Railroad Commission regulates our state's most important industry, oil and gas. It hasn't regulated railroads for several decades. You also might be surprised, no, wait a minute, you're libertarians, you won't be surprised, to find out that our legislature won't change the name. They like it to be an obscure agency. They like it to be an agency whose commissioners, though elected by the people, continue to insist that they can have a dual role of both the oil and gas industry's champion as well as its regulator. For those of us that know about regulatory capture, that's an open admission of regulatory capture. Publicly. You might also be surprised, no, you're libertarians, you would not be surprised, to find out that the Texas Railroad Commission once controlled the price of oil in the world. They did it by restricting oil and gas production in Texas. Some have even suggested they did that in order to transfer wealth from the consuming states to Texas, the producing state. But there's another reason that I'm running. One of the main reasons I'm running is Texas needs to assure ballot access for 2018. The way we get ballot access in 2018 without a petition drive is to get 5% in a statewide race. My race is the only executive position on the ballot this fall, although we do have 6 judicial races, all with libertarians in them. So we're working very hard to avoid a petition drive that might cost $250,000 by winning at least 5% in one of these races. My supporters should know, however, 5% is not enough. 5% is our floor. With 10%, they will quit ignoring us. With 15%, maybe we just become the second largest party in Texas. They have one party rule there, not two. So please, any of you who are so inclined, please join us in Texas in our fight to get ballot access for 2018. Thank you.
Thank you, Candidate Miller. As a reminder for the body, let's please maintain order and respect while the speakers are speaking. And in case anyone has forgotten, to learn more about the party, please go to lp.org. The number one thing that you can do to help the libertarian movement is to run for office. Do what Dr. Miller's doing. Run for office as a libertarian. Get all that free media coverage. Help to cut government and advance liberty. Microphone one.
Mr. Chair, point of personal privilege. It's kind of hard to get to walk through the aisles at this point because there's so many people standing in the aisles. Can we please ask people if they're having conversations to move them into the rows?
Okay. There is a point of privilege, and I'm going to make a point of order. Will the group in the middle over there please maintain order during these proceedings? If you want to shout, please do that outside of the convention hall. If you are currently in an aisle, you are making it difficult for people to go through the aisles. Please return to your seats, or if you wish to have a conversation, there is an entire beautiful hotel out here, and you can talk about anything you like for as long as you like. Now that I have a couple moments, I want to remind everyone, if you have a cell phone, you have access to Facebook. You can be using this time right now to be spreading the libertarian message among your friends. You can share the live stream of this event. You can thank C-SPAN and all the other media who's here right now for covering this event. If you haven't done so, look around. There are many people from the media who are looking to interview libertarians to understand why we want to cut government. Why do we want to advance liberty? Is there a point of order at microphone one or a point of information? Go ahead.
Test. Point of information. Chris Go. Robinson, Kentucky. Of the top 20 subjects happening right now that are trending on Twitter, Three of them is the Libertarians and this convention.
I want to take a quick moment to thank you for that. And in addition to Twitter covering us, I want to thank the following media for finally realizing that there is a party that wants less government and more freedom instead of more government and more statism. I would like to thank right now the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, the LA Times, CNN, Politico, ABC, CBS, NBC, 538, Fox, MSNBC, Slate, C-SPAN, and the Huffington Post. Thank you so much for the excellent coverage you're giving this convention and helping make less freedom and less government and more freedom an increasing political reality in America. You guys have seen that media coverage comes when you run candidates. Listen, like most of you, I am also not a lawyer. I don't have a degree in political science. Many of these people who have run for office, they're not lawyers. They don't have degrees in political science. I promise, if you are dedicated to cutting government, the number one thing you can do is to run for office. When you run for office, you will get thousands of dollars of free media coverage, even if it's not a time like this, where it's probably more like millions. But even if you run in a time when no one's paying attention, you will get coverage for the cause of liberty. This is your chance to tell everyone why we need to end the Department of Education, why we need to end the Fed. If you run for office, that message will be heard. Go ahead, microphone one.
Just a point. I want to recognize someone, if I could, from the Michigan delegation.
Go ahead.
One of the founders of the delegation in Michigan, the Michigan Libertarian Party of Michigan, someone who was at the Denver convention, who has run for office every 2 years since, Mr. James Hudler. Jim, can you stand up, James? He's currently running for the Board of Regents of the University of Michigan. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Is there a point of information or order? If there's no... guys in the back of the room, if you can please keep it down during the proceedings. If you want to make a point, you can make it quietly or you can make it outside. Let's maintain order at all times here. As long as there's no objection, I would like to invite to the podium a candidate for U.S. Senate from New York, one of the most active people in social media who has done so much to spread the libertarian message. Please welcome Alex Merced.
Hey everybody, how's everyone doing? The name's Alex Merced from New York, and I'm running for U.S. Senate against everybody's favorite busybody, Chuck Schumer. Okay? Now that's gonna be a tough fight, okay? He has one of the most national profiles of any senator, so that means I need to build a profile to go against that. And I've been marketing myself as the pro-U candidate, because at the end of the day, we're not talking about what the answer for all of the country's greatest challenges is you. It's all about individual empowerment. So when I go around and I talk to people, I talk about how some answers, like government, take forever, and usually when they finally do something, it doesn't work. It's worse than if they had done nothing. But you could do something today. You can do something right now. And sometimes, no matter what people think about the role of government, when I tell them that they can do something today, they can do something now, it opens up their mind. They look at it differently. And I talk about liberty because I'm tired. Because when people ask me, when I sit there and say, it's time to shrink government, they ask me, well, what's your argument? What's your case? And I'm like, why should I have to make a case? Why should I have to make a case for my freedom? Freedom should be the assumption. Should always start with the assumption that you are free. Okay? But basically, at the bottom line, is we're doing a lot of things over there in New York, and we have a lot of great candidates this year in New York. Not only am I running for U.S. Senate, but we got Tony D'Orazio running for Congress. We got David Pasek running for Congress. We got Michael McDermott running for Congress. We're going to have an exciting year. We're going to bring a pro-U message to the people of New York. And the thing is that when it comes to not just my candidacy, but all the candidacy of the people here, it takes all of us to get that message across. We should all be spreading the name of all our candidates. We want people to sit there and remember the names of libertarian candidates across the country. We want to encourage people to start chapters across the country, to go out and be part of the communities across the country. And we should all So again, as you guys, most of you probably know me more from social media, and I have started Facebook pages, groups, and whatnot to help candidates get the message out so that we can all channel that message through a couple focal points. So again, if you're a candidate, please get in touch so I can help give you access to some of those Facebook pages, help in some of the organizing, etc. Okay, because at the end of the day, we need to go from all planks. And it's all a team effort as well. And also, if anyone needs a website, I'm more than glad to help them with that, as I've helped with many of the candidates in New York. But again, thank you guys for listening to me today. And again, it's about you, it's about the message, it's about individual empowerment. Thank you very much. Have a great day, and I'll see you guys.
Will the delegation chair of Mississippi please come to the front? And I'm going to ask the body a question. Does anybody have an objection to my asking the sergeant of arms to remove anybody who is engaging in disruptive behavior? It seems that there's quite a bit of objection. I will ask politely first, please make sure that people can hear the speakers who are your candidates, who are fighting for your freedoms, who are trying to get their message out to you and to your fellow family members, friends, people you don't know. Will the Mississippi...
And it also interferes with Secretary Tallying.
And it also interferes with the tallying, which makes this process take longer than it actually needs to. Are there any points of information or other privileged motions? Most of your interaction with the government is not actually with the federal government. Most of it is with your state and local government. Right now, as long as there's no objection, I would like to welcome to the stage Erin Adams. She is running for a state-level position, and she's going to tell you how she's going to make the lives of you, your family, your friends, and perfect strangers better. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Erin Adams. I'm a candidate for state legislature in Oklahoma. Thank you. I'm here to talk to you, actually, about growing our party. The message of liberty is a powerful one, and it's inspired people since ancient times, and I believe we need to tap into that inspiration now. This election is a unique opportunity handed to us by the Republicans and the Democrats. Both of those parties are nominating unabashed big government statists, leaving us as the sole voice for liberty in this election. The main way we can capitalize on this is by reaching out to the disaffected voters of both parties. And in order to reach out, we need to pull together. This means we need to have less infighting. My media liaison has started calling the no true Scotsman logical fallacy no true libertarian instead, which I believe is telling. We are the original big tent party because we don't care what you do with your life or your money as long as you don't take from someone else by force or fraud. We can and do disagree on many things, but our takeaway has always been and will always be advancing liberty. As a libertarian candidate, I feel, as I'm sure some of you do as well, that it's important to show others that not only can we work together within our own ranks, but in true nonpartisan fashion with others as well. This is why, in the name of liberty, I've been working with the Veterans Party to attempt to help them gain ballot access in my great state of Oklahoma. I would challenge each of you to question what it is that you can do to aid in a spirit of cooperation without abandoning our principles. We didn't get into this mess overnight, and it's unlikely that we'll get out of it overnight. So should we talk about our ideals? Absolutely. Should we immediately propose jumping straight to that ideal? Maybe not. Sometimes it turns people off, but we do need to start looking in the right direction. The momentum of the last 100 years has been toward bigger and more bloated government. Too often, libertarians focus on the goal without thinking about how to get there. which is also going to turn people off. And ladies and gentlemen, we need to start looking at how to bring people in, not ways to turn people off. One way that we can bring people in is to be welcoming of those who have changed their opinions and now agree with us. Not everyone starts off a libertarian, and we need to be just as welcoming of those who come to our viewpoint later in life as we are some of our early members. Glenn Beck, for instance, has talked about the hostility he encountered as he converted to the libertarian viewpoint. Should we instantly embrace those who claim to have converted? Clearly, we should not. However, we should be willing to talk, to discuss, to listen to their concerns, and especially to answer them respectfully. We should be happy that someone is taking steps towards supporting liberty and not dismissive of someone who isn't in full agreement with our own view. I have a different view of the optimal role of government from others in this party. This does not make me any less a libertarian. This does not make any of you any less a libertarian. Considering that there's a long way to go until we get to a practical disagreement, in every instance, we should be working together to choose liberty. Thank you.
A year ago in Oklahoma, people couldn't even vote libertarian, and now we have people who are running for office as libertarians. And if you are in a state where you can run for office, please strongly consider doing so. There's a few announcements. First, as many of you know, this new logo was designed in Georgia by Will Taylor, who did such amazing work, and Georgia right now has just 50 of the official new logo pins left from the Libertarian Party of Georgia. If you want one, please go to the table. If there's no objection, I will invite Emily Salvette to give the Credentials Committee report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good afternoon. At 12:20, we had 920 delegates and 86 alternates registered in attendance who are eligible, and that's 1,006 people as alternates and delegates in this room, and congratulations on that. And those alternates and delegates can cast 946 votes. So on behalf of the Credentials Committee, I'd like to move the revised roll of delegates submitted be the official roll of the voting members of this convention.
All in favor of that list say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. It passes.
Thank you. Also on behalf of the Credentials Committee, I'd like to move that these names be added to the roll of those eligible to register to vote at this convention. Jessica Bell, a Nevada delegate. Diane Chalmers, Wyoming alternate. Alice Lilly, California alternate. Donald Meinhausen, New York delegate. Christina Sirois, Wyoming alternate. Fred Stitt, California alternate. Aaron Wenhold, New York delegate. And Nick Zedisian, North Dakota alternate.
Mr. Chairman, parliamentary inquiry.
Point of parliamentary inquiry at microphone number two.
Mr. Chairman, are we not voting and so motions are not allowed?
You caught me. You are correct. As the point of order is well taken, we will rescind the results of the previous vote. The Credentials Committee Chair will make the same recommendation as soon as the vote's over.
Thank you, sir.
Is this yours?
No, it's not.
Oh, that's interesting. I wanted to make an announcement. Someone found a Samsung tablet in the smoking area. If you have lost that tablet, please check registration desk 2. The press conference went well, by the way. Microphone number two.
Chris Madden from Illinois. Point of parliamentary inquiry, Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
What would be the appropriate motion to make at this time to not have each state delegate's total read out aloud?
So, I am going to rule that it would be absolutely 100% in order for someone to make a motion right now to suspend the rules to dispense with the announcement by state of the votes for the second ballot. Is there any objection to that motion? All in favor of suspending with reading out loud all 50 states the vote totals and just showing them on the screen, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
That's way more than two-thirds. We will just project the votes on the screen. Thank you, sir. Are you seeking to be recognized at microphone three?
At the appropriate time, Mr. Chairman, maybe just before you announce the result, as I would love to get your attention at that time.
All right, thank you. We need the ballots from Kansas and Washington State. Will those delegation chairs turn in their votes so that we can pick the next president of the United States? Microphone two.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Point of information. I just want to remind everybody that Outright Libertarians is having our biannual meeting at 6 o'clock p.m. in room 2456. Well, actually, it's 15 minutes after we adjourn, so like if we get out early, it'll
15 minutes later. 15 minutes after we adjourn, Outright Libertarians will be having their caucus meeting in room 2456. Thank you, Mr. Shipley.
Thank you.
And by the way, Mr. Shipley, I like the color you picked. Microphone one.
Point of parliamentary inquiry.
Parliamentary inquiry, Mr. Perry.
Since the balloting or the ballot counting is still going, is that previous motion not out of order?
Which motion are you asking about?
The motion to flash the results on screen instead of having the states read those.
The chair has ruled that it is in order. Would you like to appeal the ruling of the chair?
I'm hearing people say yes.
All right, we'll do it then. Do you care to speak to it, or are we going to be good? I think we can just go to vote on this. All in favor of sustaining the ruling of the chair that it was in order to suspend the rules in order to dispense with people walking to the microphones and announcing the ballot state by state, please say aye.
Aye.
All those who wish to overturn that ruling of the chair, please say no.
No.
The ruling of the chair stands. Microphone number two.
Mr. Chairman, having attended, this is my 10th national convention, I am reminded of a certain custom that the chair used to participate in which he raised his hands, and when we chanted, 1-800-ELECT-US. And it seems to me this would be an interesting way to pass the time.
Let's try it. I'm going to raise my hands, and everyone's going to chant 1-800-ELECT-US. Let's see how this works.
1-800-ELECT-US.
I like that. Hey, let's see if we can update it for the modern age. Maybe if I raise my hands, everyone can say lp.org.
lp.org.
These hands are magical. Thank you, Dr. Phillies. Microphone number two.
Point of inquiry, sir.
Point of inquiry, microphone two.
I'm looking at the Libertarian Party Facebook page, and it says now there's 631,314 likes. My question is that accurate, that that's 205 more than it was at the beginning of the last ballot?
I believe so. Thank you. Is anyone else seeking to be recognized at this time while they're tallying the votes? Have we received ballots from all states? They are all in, so it's all over but the counting. Wait,
we have Kansas?
We have everybody.
Voting is over now.
voting is over and other business is in order, and I would recognize Ms. Mills, who is approaching microphone. What? If your state delegation chair has turned in your ballot, I'm going to ask the secretary, is this gentleman allowed to cast this vote that he is holding? We will resolve that, but it is my ruling that I will recognize Ms. Mills at microphone number two because I think she has a motion to suspend the rules.
Point of order.
There's a point of order right behind her. Mr. Wilford, what's your point of order, sir?
Is it not parliamentary procedure that a ballot is not complete till the results are announced?
I have been advised by the parliamentarian that with all the votes having been cast and only being tabulated, that in fact it is in order to do business at this time. Ms. Mills, please state your motion.
Rachel Mills from North Carolina. Motion to suspend the rules for considering of a resolution.
For how long?
5 minutes.
For 5 minutes. Could you read the resolution you would like us to consider?
Yes, sir. Resolved. For jointly guaranteeing an unprecedented wave of interest in political alternatives, for arguably doing more to disentangle voters from deeply held, long-standing political loyalties than we ever could on our own, for opening minds to seek out new ideas of governance, the Libertarian Party awards jointly Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton a Liberty Outreach Award. Think about it.
All in favor of suspending the rules for 5 minutes to consider adopting this resolution, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, please say no. Would Ms. Mills approach the secretary's assistance desk to provide that motion in writing? I think, are we ready to move to a vote on this resolution? Would anyone like to debate this resolution? All right, all in favor. Actually, Ms. Mills, if you can get it right up to me so I can just read it before we pass it. The resolution reads, resolved. For jointly guaranteeing an unprecedented wave of interest in political alternatives, for arguably doing more to disentangle voters from deeply held, long-standing political loyalties than we ever could on our own, for opening minds to seek out new ideas of governance, the Libertarian Party awards jointly Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton a Liberty Outreach Award. All in favor of passing that resolution, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed. I believe that that passed. And let's see if these hands work again. It was still set for the website, but let's try the phone number. Thank you. I'll recognize microphone number one.
Marc Hinkle of California. I move to suspend the rules to introduce a resolution that says the following. The delegates at the Libertarian Party 2016 convention wish to thank Vicki Kirkland for her efforts to bring this convention to Orlando, Florida. We wish her a speedy and full recovery from her recent illness.
Is there any objection to suspending the rules for that matter? I hear no objection. Is there any objection? I actually want to vote on this because I want to hear you. All in favor of passing the resolution, please read it again. Loud and proud.
The delegates at the Libertarian Party 2016 convention wish to thank Vicki Kirkland for her efforts to bring this convention to Orlando, Florida. We wish her a speedy and full recovery from her recent illness.
All in favor of that resolution, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It passes unanimously. Mr. Starr, you have a point of inquiry. Go ahead.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, at this time, I beg your indulgence and the indulgence of this body, I wrote down the information you gave me. I handed out to somebody out there in the hotel, so I didn't bother maintaining it. Could you just please tell me, if I want to find out more information about the Libertarian Party, how might I do that?
Well, first, I want to tell you what the phone number is. And then I want to make sure that you know what the website is. Does that answer the gentleman's point of inquiry?
You know, Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry, I'm a little hard of hearing. Just one more time, please.
Yep, the phone number again. And the website.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Starr. I am informed that we have the results of the presidential second ballot. There's a point of inquiry number two. Go ahead.
David Zebel, delegate from Georgia. In between the two ballots, the secretary stood and announced a new number for the total number of delegates. My question is, what is the baseline number for the votes that should be cast on the second ballot, given that the chair ruled out of order changes thereto?
She did not add any of those changes. I can assure you of that.
What is the baseline number then for the votes cast in the second ballot?
What is the maximum number of ballots that could be cast?
Yes, sir.
Yes. I believe it's in the 990s, but I could be, or it's a 940s.
She said 946 in between the ballots.
946 then, or wait.
She has
on her screen. Wait, hold up. I see on her screen an indication that 942 is the number of credentialed delegates for this ballot.
Thank you, sir.
And 928 of them were cast, so you guys are doing good work. Now, I want to announce that after I announce the results of the presidential nomination, after we announce who will be the next president of the United States, there will be a media availability in Ballroom A 10 minutes after the vote is announced. So any press who wishes to talk to the chair, the political director, anyone like that, I will be holding a press conference over there. Now, are we ready? All right. I'd ask the secretary to pull up the summary results of this ballot. All right, so what we're gonna do first, we're gonna make sure we get this right. So the secretary is going to, if we could put the secretary's screen up, the secretary is going to scroll through her spreadsheet, and I want each state chair, each state delegation chair, to look carefully at the screen. We're starting with the A's, and make sure that those vote totals match what you turned in. If you see anything that is incorrect, please raise a hand real fast. Go ahead and start scrolling. Well, back up a couple. So this is Delaware through Kentucky. All right, go to the next one. Indiana through Mississippi. Back up one. Is Illinois satisfied? All right, keep going then. All right, that's through New Jersey. Go ahead. That's through Rhode Island. Everybody good on this one? All right, let's keep going. Just don't go too far. That's Pennsylvania through Washington, West Virginia. Alphabetically, the last state, right? Oh, Wyoming. You got in there. All right. Now that we've reviewed all of the ballots cast, who's ready to hear who our nominee for the next president of the United States will be? Madam Secretary, please display the results of the election. All right, if you could all sit down for a moment. I'm going to ask, if everyone's seen the results, I'm going to ask the secretary to take those off the screen and ask the AV people to play the Johnson video.
This is an
Whose Samsung is this? Do you know, is that Arvin?
This is an independent documentary about Gary Johnson.
Do you know who this is?
It's one of the candidates for president, Gary Johnson. He used to be governor of New Mexico, and then he said things politicians don't often say.
Man is superior to government and should remain master over it, not the other way around.
Telling the truth can result in a lot of heat that a lot of people can't stand. And politicians, for the most part, do everything they can to avoid the heat.
Crisis, I think, results from cover-up.
Right now, we have sued the Presidential Debate Commission.
As governor, I was labeled the most dangerous politician in America. People in New Mexico today wave at me with all five fingers, not just one.
To me, Republicans, Democrats, Tweedledee, Tweedledum.
I happen to think the term limits is a silver bullet. That if term limits were in effect, politicians would do the right thing as opposed to whatever it takes to get reelected.
Less government is better. The biggest issue facing our country right now, I think, is the fact that we continue to spend more money than what we take in. And the ramifications of this at some point is going to be a monetary collapse, and that's going to be ugly.
My next door neighbor's two dogs have created more shovel-ready jobs than this current administration.
There's a mindset among Americans that you have to go out and get a job when here we have a situation where you can go out and make your own job. It's something that's not taught in school. It should be taught in school. It's not, and it's not taught from a political standpoint.
As a business owner, I look to the future of employees. And what I tell everyone is that they should become their own entrepreneur.
You gotta love the process. You gotta love what you're doing. And if you do that, then good things happen.
I believe the biggest issue facing this country right now is that government is too big, it tries to do too much, and it spends too much. Money is freedom. And so when government takes away my money, they're taking away my freedom. They're taking away my ability to spend my money the way that I want to spend my money. I advocate eliminating income tax, eliminating corporate tax, abolishing the IRS, and replacing it with a federal consumption tax. I say, let's use the fair tax as a template for how we dot the I's and cross the T's to, in fact, implement a national consumption tax. And if eliminating corporate tax doesn't create tens of millions of jobs in this country, I don't know what will. Wasting your vote is voting for somebody that you don't believe in.
I think I would be president of the United States today if people just heard what I have to say.
I tell the truth. And it's really hard to do any damage to somebody who's willing to tell the truth, regardless of the consequences.
The Libertarian Party will be on the ballot in all 50 states, so the Libertarian Party is the third party.
I wouldn't be doing this if there weren't the opportunity to actually win.
Microphone number one.
Mr. Chairman, at the appropriate time, on behalf of the Gary Johnson campaign, we would like to ask and motion for a 15-minute recess at the appropriate time.
For a 15-minute recess, just for what purpose?
Just to give us a breather.
Well, I think that, so let me bring everybody up to speed on where I think we are, and we can see whether you guys agree. My understanding, I was about to invite Governor Johnson up to accept the nomination, but before I do, What I would like to do is reschedule the press availability. I'll be available 10 minutes after we adjourn for a lunch break. I think there might be a motion to suspend the rules, to amend the agenda, to add a 45-minute lunch break immediately following the acceptance speech of Governor Johnson. Mr. Goldstein?
So moved.
So moved. Is there any objection to a 45-minute recess after the acceptance speech of Governor Johnson? There is an objection. All in favor of having a 45-minute recess, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay.
Point of information, Mr.
Mr. Goldstein, microphone two.
At what time will we reconvene then?
We will reconvene 45 minutes after the end of the speech and any privilege motions that might come up after the end of the speech. The token deadline by the Secretary's watch is going to be 20 minutes after 12:56 p.m. for vice presidential tokens. They would need to be turned in no later than 1:16 p.m. Microphone two.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to move to suspend the rules to allow any candidate that was eligible for president to submit their tokens for vice presidential should they wish.
What I'm hearing the gentleman say is that he's making a motion to suspend the rules to allow any presidential candidate who was nominated to place their name into nomination for vice president. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Point of order. There is a second for that motion to suspend the rules.
Point of order, Mr. Chair.
Point of order where?
Microphone three.
Microphone three.
We had recently voted down that very same motion. Is it appropriate to bring it up a second time?
I am going to rule that it is in order at this time for two reasons. I'll explain myself. First of all, we have different information now. The previous time it was attempted to make this type of suspension was during the balloting, which is not really a good time for those things. The second reason is just it's been a long history in our party that we do this. So I'm going to ask all in favor of suspending the rules to allow anyone who is nominated for president to play. Point of order where?
Microphone
number one. Yes, Mr.
Daniel Hayes from Louisiana. Mr. Chairman, would it be in order for us to have people cast two votes for that role? Because that's what's happening now by switching these tokens.
I have already ruled that it will be in order. So there we go. Now we'll move to a vote. All in favor of suspending the rules in that manner, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, please say no.
No!
All in favor, please stand up. Please sit down. All opposed, please stand up. It does fail. The rules will not be suspended in that way. And so, where we are at now is any presidential candidate who wishes to have their name placed in nomination for vice president will need to turn in sufficient vice presidential nominating tokens no later than 1:16 p.m. Is the governor around? Oh, if the governor could be around pretty soon. We're going to do the credentials report real fast. Come on, Ms. Salvette.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It should go fast because we've already heard it. At 12:20, we had 920 delegates, 86 alternates registered in attendance and that's 1,006 in the room, and they can cast 946 votes. And I'll combine the reports this time. There were 8 people who were asking to be added to the roll of people who can register and become in attendance on this floor. Jessica Bell, Nevada delegate, Diane Chalmers, Wyoming alternate, Alice Lilly, California alternate, Donald Meinhausen, New York delegate, Christina Sirois, Wyoming alternate, Fred Stitt, California alternate, Aaron Wenhold, New York delegate, and Nick Zedian, North Dakota alternate. I'm sure I mispronounced each name in a different way this time. On behalf of the Credentials Committee, I move the revised rule be the voting members of this convention.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, delegates.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, microphone number one.
While we're waiting for the presidential nominee, I would like to make a motion to suspend the rules concerning quorum.
Okay, go ahead and make your motion.
Okay. And then I'd like to speak why I'm asking for this.
You get to do that if we move to suspend the rules to consider it. For how long?
For 5 minutes.
Okay, go ahead and make your motion.
At any convention session previously published in the agenda to elect officers, LNC members, or judicial committee members, the normal quorum requirement is waived.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman.
Point of...
Point of order, Mr. Chairman.
I've gotten them from three different directions right now. I am informed that motion to suspend the rules is out of order because it attempts to suspend a bylaw and that is not something
Correct.
This body can do. I'm sorry, Mr. Bachrach.
Okay, well, let me explain a problem that we have.
This would be a point of information.
Okay.
Go ahead.
The secretary of our party told the Credentials Committee 2 months ago that it was against Robert's Rules of Order to sign out people from the convention. So therefore, we have not staffed our committee in order to have people at the sign-out desk. So it's going to be a problem. I just want people to know that if you want business to continue, then you're going to have to come to the registration desk and sign out. And if there is a lineup, it's because we were not told in advance that we would have to staff this function.
Thank you, sir.
Point of information, Mr. Chairman.
Point of information at microphone number three.
One of the proposals that came out of the Bylaws Committee report, which we did not get to, was to change the quorum requirement so that it would be reduced to 30% once we get to the election of officers. So if somebody wants to at some point in time bring that back up, that might be appropriate. I'm not suggesting we do that, but it's in order if one wanted to.
Thank you. Are there any other privileged motions? Microphone number one.
Rich Tomaso, Chair of New Hampshire. I'm not sure if this is a question for the chair or a point of information, but
go ahead.
I was curious if the chair would be interested in knowing that the Libertarian Party's Twitter feed, LP National, has been gaining more than 500 followers a day during the convention.
Thank you, Mr. Tomaso. I'm going to inquire whether or not Governor Johnson wishes to make an acceptance speech at this time for 5 minutes. If I don't, is Governor Johnson here? Everyone, please stand and give a round of applause for the nominee for President of the United States, Governor Gary Johnson.
Thank you very much. You have no idea how much what just happened means to me. Thank you. I've always said that it's your hard work, it's every one of your work over the years that has gotten us to this point, and I recognize that. And I will work as hard as I can to represent everybody in this room. Look, for those that weren't supportive, I just want to reiterate a couple of things. I tell the truth. I am not a liar. And I make plenty of mistakes. But what I say here at this convention is what I say everywhere, wherever I go, and I believe it is a really libertarian message wherever I go. And right now, leaving this convention, I think that millions of people are going to be trying to understand what it is to be a libertarian, and it is going to be my voice describing that to the best of my ability. And I realize the confidence that you've put in me to be that spokesperson, and I'm very, very grateful of that. Now, that said, we're going to move on to the vice president. And I understand that you get to choose the vice president. But I just want you to know, if it's not Bill Weld, I don't think we have the opportunity of being elected president of the United States. And that is not to take anything away from any of the candidates up here on stage. Jim Gray in 2012 did not make one national media appearance, and don't think we didn't try to have Jim Gray be on the national media. Since Bill Weld announced that he is seeking the vice presidential nomination, I would say at a minimum he's made 25 national media appearances. And going. And not to take anything away from any of the candidates, nothing away from any of the candidates. But Bill Weld was my role model. Bill Weld was libertarian, Republican. Bill Weld was denied the nomination by Jesse Helms to be ambassador to Mexico because Jesse described him as pro-gay, pro-choice, and pro-medical marijuana at a time when nobody else was talking about this. It's your choice. We can go out there and we can make, and you've kind of sort of made a choice here already, and that is that we do have the opportunity to reach millions and millions of Americans. Talk about fundraising. The total amount of funds since I've been in politics, directly or indirectly, that I have raised is probably about $8 million. If you make that comparison with Bill Weld, the number is closer to $250 million. It's a reality. It is a reality. And I'm asking you all to recognize that reality. And I'm also asking you to recognize that you did nominate me for president. And I'm hopefully going to get elected president of the United States. The first consideration that people are going to look at when they look at a vice president, the first consideration, maybe the only consideration, is can that person actually step in and be vice president of the United States? I'm just going to ask you to make that determination with those that are on stage. I trust in all of you that moving forward, that you can see, I hope you can see the wisdom of this Libertarian Party exploding. And at a minimum, or let's just not say, at a minimum, I think we're in the presidential debates. If it's not Bill Weld, I don't think that happens. If it is Bill Weld, not to take anything away from anybody else that is on the stage, but if it is Bill Weld, there's a real possibility that we can achieve major party status in this country. And who would have dreamed that was possible 4 years ago? I have never been involved in this ever without the notion of potentially winning. In 2012, people would ask, well, gee, how come it is that you never really caught on?
Actually, I caught on big. This whole thing has been just like this from day one. But when they don't poll you, when they don't recognize that you go from zero to 1,300,000 votes, it's hard to make that pitch. Well, right now at 10% of the vote, that's like 18 million people being represented right now. Just understand the opportunity, please. I'm laying it in your hands, and I know that you're going to make, I know you're going to make the right decision. Thank you to all of you. You have worked so hard. Every single one of you have worked so hard, and so much money has been spent over so many years for ballot access, and here we are. I mean, this is, at some point, did anybody get involved with the Libertarian Party hoping that this might someday happen? Was it going to be perfect? No, it wasn't going to be perfect, but it is here and it is now. So, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you.
General Washington. We are outgunned, outmanned, outnumbered, outplanned. We gotta make it all outstand. Hey yo, I'm gonna need a right hand man. Check it. Can I be real a second? For just a millisecond. Let down my guard and tell the people how I feel a second.
I know you guys have been loud, but one more round of applause for the next nominee, for the next president of the United States of America, Governor Gary Johnson. It is now 20 minutes after 1 o'clock. The deadline has passed for vice presidential signature tokens to be turned in. They will not be accepted after this time. There will be a press conference in salon or ballroom A in 10 minutes. So at 1:30, we will resume business 45 minutes after now, which by my lawyer math is 5 minutes after 2. At 2:05, we will resume. And we will have nominations and elections for the office of vice president. Thank you.